Good afternoon. It's an ever-changing world in football. Only one top-flight game in England kicked off at 3 o'clock, but there are plenty of other matches for us to follow between now and the final whistles. Gavin Peacock, Gary Pallister and Garth Crooks are here in the studio, and they're never short of an opinion on the footballing issues of the day. The Aston Villa-West Ham game has their attention at the moment. More on that in a minute. Villa 1, West Ham 0, the latest score. First up, Manchester United have moved to the top of the Barclays Premier League table. Jonathan Pearce was at Old Trafford for the champions' lunchtime victory with Wigan.
What looked like becoming an afternoon of frustration for Manchester United was turned into a sixth league win on the spin by a moment of Carlos Tevez class. Already without seven sideline players, they lost Vidic and O'Shea to first-half injuries, saw two penalty appeals waved away and lacked fluency against Wigan's stubborn game plan. But that was thrown awry by captain Mario Melchiot's injury after 51 minutes. Giggs then hit a post, and when Rooney and Anderson combined to sweetly send Tevez away after 54 minutes, he shrugged off two defenders to end the deadlock. After the goal drought, the floodgates opened. Ronaldo headed the second from close range. 5 minutes later, tapped in the third from a lovely Rooney cross, and Rooney himself wrapped it up with his first Premier goal of the season, 8 minutes from time. United atop. Goal drought? Are you sure?
Manchester United top of the table by a point, but they've played two games more than Arsenal. Latest news now on the other English Premier League game that's being played this afternoon. Ivan Gaskell is watching Aston Villa versus West Ham at Villa Park.
Yes, Aston Villa 1, West Ham 0. That half-time scoreline still. In his pre-match programme notes, Villa manager Martin O'Neill said, bring back the excitement. The Villa fans are happy enough at the break here. Not yet on the pitch for the second half, but they'll want more of the same. They lead 1-0 thanks to that Gray Gardner free kick.
Enjoy your lunch, Ivan. What is your verdict on the first half performance as far as Aston Villa are concerned?
Villa looked very bright. I'm not sure they deserve to be ahead. I thought the goal was dubious. I thought the referee, Steve Tanner, made a big mistake by giving Villa a free kick on the edge of the box. I thought Gabidon was harshly dealt with.
Is that the way you saw it? Was it a free kick?
Garth could have a point on the free kick. I'm not sure. He was definite from the start. It was no free kick. I have to disagree in as much as I think that Villa deserved to be in the lead from the weight of their play and the speed which they've got down the wings. Young is torturing Lucas Neal. Agbon Lahore looks sharp. Luke Moore as well. They've got a young, vibrant English, primarily English team as well, with the young players they've got there. And they've just got a bit too much for West Ham. The only thing is, Ray, they could be more in front at the moment, and West Ham will feel, if they can get an early goal back, that they may be able to get something up the game.
Comfortable for Manchester United, having conceded a goal in around about 10 hours now.
Yeah, fantastic at the back, although they have lost Nemanja Vidic today. He got a knock to the head, he had an egg on the side of his face, he had to come off, he wanted to stay on, shows you how brave he is. They also lost John O'Shea in the first half, and for half an hour it looked like a typical Old Trafford game this year. A lot of possession, no real threat, didn't create a lot of chances. All changed in the last quarter of an hour of the first half, created a couple more, and second half it was vintage United, the tore of it, Wigan apart, and deservedly won by four goals to nil.
Manchester United top of the Premier League table to Scotland. Great week for the Old Firm in the Champions League. It's Rangers in action today in the Clydesdale Bank Premier League. Celtic play tomorrow. Rangers trying to return to top spot in the table. It's second against third. Unbeaten Hibs are their opponents. Brian McLaughlin's at Ibrox.
It's Rangers nil, Hibs nil. No goals as yet, Ray, and it's been Hibs that have looked the more impressive side in opening 45. Guillaume Bouzlan in midfield has been controlling the game for the Easter Road side. Rangers' best chance fell to Charlie Adams, but he snatched at his effort and pulled the ball wide of the target. Rangers nil, Hibs nil, second half just underway.
Also on the SPL, Dundee United and Motherwell, fourth against fifth at kick-off. Ian Turner reporting.
Already into the second half, 0-0 United yet to concede a home league goal this season. They're halfway to extending that record to five games. Stephen Hughes almost got the first away goal here at Tannadice Ice a moment ago, round the keeper, but Prince Bobbin cleared off the line, 0-0.
And it's Hearts versus Falkirk. Steve Sutton's at Tynecastle.
Yes, Ray, second half just underway and Hearts lead by 2-0. They took the lead as early as the fifth minute with Odrius Kasanavicius knocking it into the goal after a cross from the right from Kingston. And then Zaliukas made it 2-0 on 26 minutes. Good value for their lead.
Teams on the way back out at Villa Park for the second half of the Aston Villa-West Ham match. And Alan Kerbishley had a real rant at the officials on the way off at half-time. Is that justified in terms of the Football Association as saying that in the future, perhaps only the captain should be allowed to talk to the referee? Well, does it set the example when you have a rant
like that? Let's be fair. I think there's a time and a place for all things. And I think at the end of the game, if the manager needs to get something off his chest, and I think he does it in a reasonable manner, I think he's entitled to say to the referee, this is what I thought, referee, please be aware in future.
But what about at half-time? What example does that set to the watching children? I'm not just singling out Alan Kerbsley here. It's a thing across the game. But what's your opinion on
this? Yeah, I mean, obviously, Alan Kerbsley is usually quite calm and collected, and it's really annoyed him. Perhaps it's the decision for the free kick for the goal. But maybe it's a case of, you know, will a referee... We had Graham Pohl on last week, and he said that now and again he'd let a manager come into the room at half-time even. And I think that's got to be a case between the referees
right
and the managers.
That can actually take the sting and the heat out of a situation.
What are West Ham going to do in this second 45 minutes, Gary? How should they address this?
I mean, they didn't play that badly in the first. They looked a threat going forward. They've lost Kamara now. He's come off. And that obviously that partnership with Ashton's not going to be there for the second half of them, because that pace did give them a bit of a threat. They brought Carlton Cole on now, who's going to give them more of a physical presence. They've got to look to get balls in the box and ask questions of the Villa defence.
Latest news now on all this afternoon's Coca-Cola Championship games. Watford ran out as the league leaders at seventh place Scunthorpe. Alan Biggs reporting.
It's Scunthorpe 1, Watford 1. A fair scoreline and a fair old game. Sweeping from one end to the other. Very direct from both sides, but no less entertaining for that. Scunthorpe almost a mirror image of Watford at times, but Watford edging it on chances. They were ahead early. Adam Johnson's near post header, the winger's third goal of his loan from Middlesbrough. But Scunthorpe hit back quickly. Great move sprung by Jim Goodwin. Early cross from Cleveland Taylor and a near post touch from Jonathan Fort. Just about getting underway for the second half. 1-1.
Charlton Barnsley second against fourth at kickoff. Charlton 7 games unbeaten, Barnsley 5 unbeaten. Dominic Cotton's at the Valley.
Yes, Ray, Charlton were in charge of the first half but failed to get a goal. They've made a change at half-time. Svetislav Todorov coming on for Luke Varney up front. We've had a minute and a half played here and no chances yet. 0-0 with Charlton firmly on top.
Southampton against West Bromwich Albion. West Bromwich Albion kicked off in third place. Roger Johnson.
Southampton 2, West Brom 1. Here too, the division's worst defence hosting its best attack. But the roles reversed today for the opening half hour. Southampton went 2 up, first from Stern John from 12 yards, the second speared in by Rudy Scatchell at an angle on the left. Normality was restored when the home defence couldn't handle Ishmael Miller and Robert Corran smashed in from close range. Forget the form book, this is an even contest. Second half's just started. Southampton lead West Brom 2-1.
Wolves against Coventry, 11th playing 5th. Mark Webber.
0-0 it still is. Injury news. Michael Gray has a hamstring problem after he limped off in the first half. Goalkeeper Wayne Hennessy went off with a hip injury after his clash and is in hospital with a precautionary x-ray. Wolves making a third substitution. Freddie Westwood coming in for some more firepower. It's all they need to take them in the lead. 0-0 at the moment.
It's not improving for Sheffield Wednesday, but it looks like Gary Megson might get his first win as the manager of Leicester City. David Garrido.
Well, certainly if the second half is anything like the first, you can pretty much put your mortgage on that, Ray. The Wednesday players back out well before the second half got underway, perhaps on the back of a hiding from Brian Laws during the half-time break. I dare say the Wednesday manager didn't have too many kind words about their display in the first 45. It was poor. Let's see how they get on this second half. It's Wednesday 0, Leicester 2, just to remind you, here at Hillsborough.
Goals starting to go in the second half of this afternoon's matches. Tenninian Park, Gareth Williams reporting.
Cardiff City 1, Burnley 1. Steve Cottrell made 3 changes for Burnley at the break, with Akinbaye, Elliott and McCann all coming on, and the changes worked on 50 minutes ball played from the left, and there was Adi Akinbaye to head past Oakes in goal. Cardiff City 1, Burnley 1.
1 from 12 at home for Cardiff. They need to improve. Harry Grayson's watching Stoke play Colchester.
Useful performance so far by Stoke, and Ryan Shawcross's 8th minute header, no more than they deserved. Fuller, Cresswell and Sidibe all could have extended their lead. Colchester have been poor. Yates, one chance to lever in front of their army of fans, all 62 of them.
To Bloomfield Road, Richard Ascombe's watching Blackpool play Plymouth.
0-0, Ray, no shots at goal this half, but Blackpool should be one up. David Fox with a gilt-edged chance just before the break. Both sides passing it nicely. A good even contest this one, but no goals.
Next stop, Portman Road, Mark Bishop on the Ipswich-Preston match.
Ipswich 1, Preston North End 0. Blue and gold is the big banner headline on the back of the local daily newspaper today, linking David Gold to a January takeover of Ipswich. Right now, current chairman David Sheepshanks will have certainly enjoyed the first half, the Tractor Boys dominating proceedings. Alan Lee's far post header the deciding factor so far, after Kenyago, rather, had shot against the Preston crossbar. Ipswich lead 1-0.
Ipswich 100% at home, Preston 1 point from 12 away. Crystal Palace against Hull, Tony Lockwood.
It's goalless, though. Hull should be out of sight after totally dominating the first 45 minutes. Palace on the back foot. Their keeper, Julian Speroni, twice frustrating a highly impressive Henrik Pedersen. Dean Marnie hit a post. Brian Hughes has wasted Hull's best second-half opportunity. It's Palace 0, Hull City 0.
In League One, the leaders Orient are losing, so Tranmere Rovers or Southend have a chance to go top of the table. Robin Bailey.
Yes, neither of them are taking advantage at the moment, but it's a good game. Southend 1, Tranmere 1. Tranmere took the lead through Ben Chorley. Adam Barrett equalised a couple of minutes before half-time. Good competitive match. Just put a matchstick between these two. It's 1-1.
Nottingham Forest are going to make progress up the table if they win this afternoon. Damian Johnson.
It's 1-1, two of Brian Clough's former sides here at the City Ground. The great man would be pleased. Both these sides stick to sound footballing principles. Not that they've produced a cracker here. Chris Commons poked Forest ahead and they had the best of the first half. Richard Barker equalised with a header, his fifth goal of the season. It's slightly more stretched in the second half. Both sides are attacking well, but it's 1-1.
Forest Hartlepool is eighth, plays fifth. League leaders in League Two, MK Dons at home to Bradford. Steve Lee reporting.
It's still MK Dons 0, Bradford 0, and under leaden skies at Stadium MK, the Dons are struggling to break down. A very determined Bradford side have defended very well. The best chance we've had, Danny Swales in the first half, a defender for MK Dons. He's header hit a post from a free kick, but MK Dons have lost their initial spark and they're finding it hard going, breaking Bradford down. It's 0-0.
So quite a departure from the norm today, with only two top flight games in England. Eight tomorrow. Here's the fixture list. We'll report on all those games over the course of tomorrow afternoon. A score service will run on BBC i via the red button and on the BBC website from 3 o'clock, and then final score on BBC two at 10 to 5, and all the goals from those games will be shown on Match of the Day 2 at 10 o'clock on BBC two. Goal news now from the Championship. Cardiff at home this afternoon. Who have they scored against? Let's hear from that on that game.
Cardiff City 2, Burnley 1. Cardiff's second goal coming on 54 minutes. Paul Parry, unmarked on the Cardiff right, received the ball. He cut back infield and his shot past Garali from 20 yards. 10 minutes into the second half. Cardiff City 2, Burnley 1.
Yeah, 1 point from 12 at home. That could be a very important 3 points for Cardiff this afternoon. Manchester United in cruise control. 4-0 win against Wigan at lunchtime, taking them to the top of the Barclays Premier League table. Let's hear from Ryan Giggs.
Very frustrating, I would imagine.
Yeah, it was. Wigan come with a game plan, getting people behind the ball. And it was a bit of a stop-start, really, first half. Players going down injured, having to tamper with a back four, players coming on, players going off. So we didn't really get into the flow of things, probably until the last 10 minutes of the first half. So it was a bit frustrating, but we knew that if we were patient, that the chances would come.
What was the main difference in the second half? Did you use the width more?
Yeah, I think so. I think the movement overall, our tempo was a lot quicker. We spread the play and everyone contributed, really. So, and it makes a difference once that first goal goes in. Wigan have got to come out and play, and it leaves gaps for players, you know, like Wayne and Cristiano and Carlos to capitalise on.
How classy was that first goal?
Yeah, it was a great individual goal. And, you know, we've got plenty of players who are capable of giving that individual brilliance. Cristiano did it last week, Carlos did it this week, and, you know, like I say, it was really important, that first goal, but really good goal.
And how important was it, Ryan, to see the youngsters playing a part in other goals as well? PK brought the ball out for the third, I think it was, and then, of course, young Simpson getting to the dead ball line, the cross for the fourth.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, their job is to defend, and they did that really well, but they show what good footballers they are as well. You know, that's what you're a United player for. You know, you can defend, but also you can play as well. And they both proved that today.
Manchester United top of the Premier League. In League One, Orient being beaten at home by Swansea. Sixth place Swansea going to make progress. But the winners of Southend Tranmere will go top of the table. Robin Bailey reporting.
Yes, it's Tranmere going top at the moment. Southend 1, Tranmere 2. A goal from Gareth Taylor. 10 minutes into the second half, he rose majestically from a free kick just to nod the ball wide of Steve Collis in the Southend goal. And really, well, I'm not sure about the marking, but it was a majestic header by Gareth Taylor, who's had a running battle with his own markers and the referee during this game over his treatment, but he's got his own back now. Gareth Taylor's second of the season and Tranmere are ahead.
Now let's go to the Hearts Falkirk game and hear from Steve Sutton.
Yes, Ray, we've had a goal. It's Hearts 3 now, Falkirk 0. A simple goal. Kanchelskis with a pass that released Velika down the left. He continued into the box. He had a look up. He could have found men in the box. He went on his own, slotted it into the net. Hearts 3, Falkirk 0.
An update from Villa Park. Now Ivan Gaskell's watching Aston Villa play West Ham.
Yes, 10 minutes into the second half. The game uneventful enough in this second half for me to finish my custard cream. Villa 1, West Ham 0. West Ham getting more to grips with the game, really, and with Villa's lively forward line that so dominated that first half an hour. In fact, Carlton Cole, a substitute here, has just had an opportunity to level it for West Ham. Should have done better, really. Didn't really get hold of it. It was an easy enough save in the end. And call me an old name dropper, if you like, but I spoke to Port Vale's potential new manager, Brian Little, at half-time, who revealed he would like the job at Vale Park. There you are, some news hot off the press.
Ivan, thanks very much. It is strange having only one game kicking off at 3 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon. What is your reading of this situation, Garth?
Well, I think John Motson hit the nail on the head earlier in Football Focus, and again on the interactive part of this show, when he talked about it's not down to TV that we've got this situation with just one Premier League game at 3 o'clock, but it's more to do with the fact that UEFA games are played on a Thursday, forcing teams to play on a Sunday. Mm. And what's wrong with having the UEFA games played on the same night as Champions League? So all
would
people
that not
can
take away from TV. Away.
It's not TV, isn't it?
It wouldn't be the interest in the UEFA Cup on the same night as the Champions League, would they?
No.
They ain't going to pay the big bucks, amount of money that they're getting by playing on the Thursday night, because everybody's going to be tuned in to the Champions League.
If you look at the UEFA Cup games, there's not an awful lot of interest from the public in those games anyway.
Well, there isn't, but they're getting more money from playing on a Thursday than they would from a Wednesday.
Well, ultimately, TV's dictating anyway.
You've got 11 or so games to get to the semi-final of the UEFA Cup, and you're not making any money. I think that you've got to really, really look at the way in which the UEFA Cup is impacting on the game. Because I'm not sure it's a busted...
The UEFA Cup really is coming like the League Cup, hasn't it? It's bit of a busty, lack of interest in
it. A bit of a busted flush, I think.
Yeah. More on this in a second, because there's a goal in the Stoke Colchester game. Harry Grayson.
And it's an equaliser for Colchester, perhaps against the run of play, although they're starting to look a bit lively. Clive Platt, the scorer. The ball came over from the left. Lovely header from close range. They're back in it. 1-1.
Bournemouth 2 up away at Crewe and St Johnstone 1 up away at Livingston in Scotland. Max Allen Gradel on 61 minutes for Bournemouth. Kenny Duca on 62 minutes for St Johnstone away at Livingston. What's your view on the 3 o'clock situation? Maybe the UEFA Cup getting in a way. Maybe the UEFA Cup has to take its chances and go alongside the Champions League.
Well, I mean, that's an option, isn't it? I mean, we haven't seen this situation, though, too many times. I mean, I can't remember a situation like this. So, you know, in general, I think it will be a case of being able to manipulate it and move it so that we have a spread. If it's regularly like it is this weekend, then I think you've got to think again.
To Ibrox, Brian McLaughlin.
Dramatic stuff here at Ibrox. It's now Rangers 0, Hibernian 1. David Murphy, the scorer, came from a Philip Moraes cross in from the right-hand side. Murphy rose like a salmon out the sea and headed past the goalkeeper, Alan McGregor. Dramatic stuff here at Ibrox. Rangers 0, Hibs 1.
Rangers hoping to go back to the top of the table. Unbeaten Hibs, that's a terrific goal for them.
It is. John Connors has done a great job there, and they're looking to try and push in and break that stranglehold that the big two have got. But I don't know that they'll do it, but what a terrific result. Obviously, Rangers playing midweek had a terrific result themselves, didn't they?
After the Lord Mayor's show.
Well, you can't see Celtic slipping up at Gretna tomorrow, can you?
Well, you can't. But, I mean, it's been a great race. I mean, last year, Celtic ran away with it again. I think there's been a transition there. Walter Smith, I think he's come in and done a fantastic job for Rangers. How they're feeling, the after effects after the great result they had at the weekend. They're not used to playing in the Champions League.
Don't you always see a team? I mean, Hearts tried it, and then Hibs did it. But no one can actually break that stranglehold that those two have got.
I mean, virtually impossible now, isn't it?
Yeah.
If you're going to be regarded as a truly great side, you're going to have to come back from Europe and turn these sides over.
Well, it was a terrific week in midweek, wasn't it, for Celtic and Rangers, particularly for Celtic beating AC Milan. But after their midweek Champions League triumph, Celtic return to action away at Gretna tomorrow, away at Bottenham got Gretna, but Gordon Strachan doesn't expect the pressure to be any different.
If you hang about here for more than 2 days, you realise we have to win every game and win it with style. And, you know, somebody was talking about, I think it was just Sky News telling us that Gordon Strachan's worried about the poor away form. Our away form's terrific, but we lost a few goals. We won 3-1, 4-1, 5-1, and because somebody scored the goal, we had a poor away form. We have to live with that pressure here at Celtic. You know, even scoring 12 and letting 3 in, it's poor away form. We won all the games.
Yeah, well played Celtic. Gordon Strachan is getting them going, isn't he?
Yes, and Celtic are regarded, as Rangers are, as a top team. So when they come back from Europe, top teams get on with the job and do it, and that's what it's all about. And I think Gordon's talking about pressure, but they're answering the critics.
I wonder, you know, the likes of the Celtics and Rangers, as opposed to in the Premier League, they haven't got as tough a games week in and week out. They're not used to playing it as tough as we are in the Premiership here. So when they do come off of a really hard slog in Europe, to go and then do it again, maybe they feel it a little bit, but Strachan's a good manager, great tactical brain. He's done a great job.
Now, Manchester United, top of the Barclays Premier League, having beaten Wigan 4-0 at lunchtime. Arsenal can respond tomorrow. They have a match against Sunderland. And Arsene Wenger has been talking about the Sunderland manager, Roy Keane.
I think what he has done last year is great because he has turned the club around in a difficult period. And that was, for me, impressive, the way he was dealing with the job and how calm he was and how resolute he was. And this year will be another test for him because it's not certainly a promotion battle, but certainly to stop the club from being relegated. And that would be a great achievement for him because to come up straight away, I think it's a big test for a very young manager. But he looks to have the mental strength to deal with that.
Well, Arsenal have played two games less than Manchester United. If they win tomorrow, they'll go back to the top of the table. What are your thoughts on the way this Premier League title race is developing?
I think it's in keeping with the way the Premiership have gone this year. It's a great product. The big debate is about the money coming into the game. Six homegrown players, says Mr. Sepp Blatter. You know, if it's not broken, why do you want to fix it? And I think Arsenal are giving all the signs that the Premiership is alive, well and kicking.
Right, let's get goal news. Scunthorpe this afternoon are playing the Championship leaders Watford. Alan Biggs is at Glanford Park.
And Watford are back in front at 2-1. The scorer of their second, Darius Henderson, his seventh of the season. He'll score prettier goals, but pretty isn't Watford. This was Tommy Smith with a close-range shot, parried, scrambled away by Joe Murphy in the Scunthorpe goal, and Henderson pounced on the rebound. Watford lead 2-1.
League leaders ahead. West Bromwich Albion kicked off third. They're away at Southampton. Roger Johnson.
They've come from 2-0 down and it's now Southampton 2, West Bromwich Albion 2. A second goal on the afternoon for Robert Corran, who held off the defender into the penalty area before beating Kelvin Davis. Southampton had the chances after the restart to bury West Brom, but the Baggies have come back into it. Now they're level, 2-2.
Charlton against Barnsley is second against fourth. Dominic Cotton's of the Valley.
Still 0-0 here, Ray, getting a little frustrating for Charlton and their fans. Zheng Ji
has had a couple of decent chances. He headed off the top of the bar just 4 minutes in to this second half and blasted one from 25 yards, not far over a few minutes later. Poor defending from Charlton then allowed their visitors, Barnsley, to have a decent chance. Grant McCann firing a free shot inches wide. 0-0 in the 65th minute.
1 3 o'clock kickoff in the Barclays Premier League. It's Villa Park. Ivan Gasker reporting.
Aston Villa 1, West Ham 0. Craig Gardner's first half goal. Still the difference between these two sides, and really there isn't much between them now. West Ham have come out and imposed themselves on this game much more. Lee Bowyer's just had a really, let's face it, a speculative header. Well, why? But it is a sign that West Ham are really getting to grips with this one. Not much in it, just that one goal, which is relatively crucial, I suppose. And Steve McLaren's here, no doubt keeping an eye on Gareth Barry and maybe Dean Ashton too.
Well, it's a cracker game at St Mary's. Back to Roger Johnson.
It's Southampton 3, West Bromwich Albion 2. The baggies were level for all of 3 minutes. A Southampton corner, it wasn't dealt with. It dropped loose in the 6 yards box and Stern John was there to poke it home for his second on the afternoon and restore a one-goal advantage for the home side. Southampton 3, West Brom 2.
Third place, West Bromwich Albion back ahead. Scunthorpe against Watford. Watford the league leaders, Alan Biggs.
And the leaders are rampant. It's Scunthorpe 1, Watford 3. 2 goals in the space of 3 minutes. Marlon King with the third, sprinting away from the challenge of Andy Crosby on a run through the middle. And he squeezed his shot past Joe Murphy. It's Scunthorpe 1, Watford 3.
Watford could be going 4 points clear. Hearts against Falkirk in the SPL, Steve Sutton.
Yes, we've had another goal, Ray. It's now Hearts 4, Falkirk 0. It's all happening as well for Christian Nardé. He's just come on as a substitute. 2 minutes later, he's popped up in the box and he's lashed the ball into the net and he's just got a yellow card before the restart. I can only think it's for excessive celebrating, but can you blame him? He'd only been on 2 minutes.
International football returns to the centre stage next week with a vital fixture list of Euro 2008 qualifiers.
Expectations mount for England and Scotland.
Can they take a giant step towards qualifying for the European Championship finals?
Two vital games, England v Estonia next Saturday at 2:30 on BBC One and Georgia v Scotland the following Wednesday at 5:45 on BBC Two. The language of football on the BBC.
Programme plans are as follows. On Saturday, you can watch coverage of England versus Estonia from Wembley on BBC One. Viewers in Scotland can watch highlights of the Scots match in Ukraine at 10:15. Then the following Wednesday, we have highlights of England's crucial trip to Moscow. That starts at 20 to 11. There's live coverage of all the other home nations' matches via the red button. After their win in France, a trip to Georgia shouldn't hold much fear for Scotland. Wales travel to San Marino and Northern Ireland face a tough trip away to Sweden. And here's the up-to-date group tables and the fixtures for the home nations and the Republic of Ireland. Top two in each group will qualify for next year's European Championship finals in Austria and Switzerland. Is Dean Ashton making a case to get a chance in the England team?
Not today. I think Martin Larsson's played him very, very well. And his opportunities have been limited. But I think this season, the last few weeks, he has shown what he's about and forced himself in there, if you like, because I think he gives them, England as well, something that they haven't got. Kind of like a younger Teddy Sheringham. You know, he's got this vision that he can play people in. Plus, he's a big man. He's got a physical presence. Mm. And he'd be a good foil for, you know, if you looked at Defoe or if you looked at Rooney or if you looked at any of the front men, Johnson, alongside him. So I think it's an option you could look at for the Estonia game, for sure.
And no win in three for Darlington, but they're two up away at Dagenham and Redbridge. Well done, Scotland, and well done the Old Firm, and well done to sort of Aberdeen, because there seems to be a resurgence in Scottish football at the moment.
Yeah, I think Walter Smith started with the Scottish team when he was in charge there. I mean, they were so far down on the look, and they were with it was perceived as Scottish football. I think he did a great job in lifting it again. He's now went to Rangers and he's lifted them as well. And the results in midweek in Europe against Milan and against Lyon were nothing short of remarkable, and hopefully it's the beginning of a huge renaissance for Scottish football.
One win in five for Huddersfield. That's one win in six now. And Walsall went from bottom to 13th with a few straight wins. But they're going to get a few more points this afternoon. Walsall 4, Huddersfield 0. Wickham 2-1 up at home to Notts County. Quick check now on a few programmes coming up very soon. Minutes to go in this afternoon's football matches. Plenty of time for scorelines to change and precious points to be won and lost. Only one top-flight game in England is underway. Gavin Peacock, Gary Pallister and Garth Crooks are paying close attention to the Aston Villa-West Ham match. 1-0, the latest score to Villa. More on that in a moment after this report from Jonathan Pearce on Manchester United's game with Wigan. Final whistle went at Old Trafford just under 2 hours ago.
What looked like becoming an afternoon of frustration for Manchester United was turned into a sixth league win on the spin by a moment of Carlos Tevez class. Already without seven sideline players, they lost Vidic and O'Shea to first-half injuries, saw two penalty appeals waved away and lacked fluency against Wigan's stubborn game plan. But that was thrown awry by captain Mario Melchiot's injury after 51 minutes. Giggs then hit a post, and when Rooney and Anderson combined to sweetly send Tevez away after 54 minutes, he shrugged off two defenders to end the deadlock. After the goal drought, the floodgates opened. Ronaldo headed the second from close range 5 minutes later, tapped in the third from a lovely Rooney cross, and Rooney himself wrapped it up with his first Premier goal of the season 8 minutes from time. United atop. Goal drought? Are you sure?
Post-match reaction from Old Trafford on the way. Latest news now from Villa Park. Ivan Gaskell's watching Aston Villa's home game with West Ham. The team's kicked off 9th and 11th.
Yes, and there isn't really much between them this afternoon. Just that one first-half goal from Gardner. Free kick on 23 minutes. But since the break, West Ham really have come more into this game. Carlton Cole, a substitute for Kamara in the first half. Well, he's become an annoying presence for the Villa defenders. He's had a couple of opportunities, though nothing has really tested the keeper. As I speak, stay with me, because that man, Rio Coca, is tearing down the right, but his cross is blocked and the danger passes. It remains 1-0.
MK Dons kicked off top of the table in League Two, but three teams within 2 points of them. Are the Dons going to remain top of the table? Steve Lee reporting.
It looks like it. MK Dons 1, Bradford 0. A goal from their captain, Keith Andrews. And I wouldn't want to be the Bradford substitute, Joe Colbeck. He lost possession and it started off an MK Dons attack. It was knocked down by Aaron Wilbraham for Keith Andrews. His shot was perfect past Reece Evans. 1-0 to the league leaders.
Ipswich and Preston both kicked off in the bottom half of the table. Mark Bishop's of Portman Road.
Another goal's gone to Ipswich, Ray. Ipswich 2, Preston North End 0. Ipswich legend John Walk just in front of me, even applauding this one. Terrific play again. Pablo Cunhago into the box. Little back flick into the path of Tommy Miller, who drilled the ball past Andy Lonergan. And this, of course, after Alan Lee scored at the near post. Ipswich on song for 8 consecutive home league victories, something they haven't done since 1982. They lead 2-0.
Looking at the way the game is going, can you see West Ham getting back into it? Are they getting something out of this, Garth?
I can, but they're desperately missing Craig Bellamy. Someone with some genuine pace up front. Carlton Cole's trying, missed one real opportunity where I think he could have equalised. That's gone. They're doing the very best, West Ham, but they're just a little bit short of, for me, pace.
Dundee United against Motherwell, Ian Turner.
At last we have a breakthrough here, Ray. Dundee United are ahead, and it was simple enough in the end. It was just a corner from the right, taken by captain Barry Robson, swung to the back post. Big Darren Dodds up from the back, headed it into the back of the net. Dundee United 1, Motherwell 0.
Stoke had proved themselves difficult to beat. One loss in 8 ahead of a home game with a Colchester side that turned up with only one win in 8. Harry Grayson reporting.
I'll tell you something, Ray. Colchester will be kicking themselves. Clive Platt got them back into the game, but just a moment ago, Leon Lawrence got a beauty. The ball was free. Only the goalkeeper to beat. He took it so well. 74 minutes gone. 2-1 to Stoke.
Well, in Scotland, champion Celtic play tomorrow away at Gretna. It's giving Rangers the chance to retake top spot in the SPL table. Brian McLaughlin is following their game with unbeaten Hibs, second play in third, and it's dramatic.
It certainly is, Ray. It's Rangers 0, Hibs 1. David Murphy with his first goal of the season, heading home substitute Philip Murray's corner. 2 firing just over from 12 yards out. Rangers have just brought on McCulloch and Naismith in an attempt to get back in level terms. They have 13 minutes to do so. It's Rangers 0, Hibs 1.
Chesterfield, second in League Two, are being held at the moment because Macclesfield have equalised. They're near the foot of the table. Francis Green on 73 minutes. Chesterfield 2, Macclesfield 2. It's Hearts versus Falkirk in Scotland. Steve Sutton reporting.
Yes, right. It's Hearts 4, Falkirk 0. Hearts in a real rich vein of form just at the moment. That's 7 goals in their last 2 games. 2 goals in each half in this game. They've got a lid firmly on the game. There may be more to come, but at the minute it's 4-0.
Latest news now and all this afternoon's Coca-Cola Championship games. Watford run out as league leaders at 7th place Scunthorpe. Alan Biggs reporting.
Scunthorpe 1, Watford 3, an ominous display from the leaders. Not an easy place this to visit Glanford Park. Scunthorpe shared the first half. Jonathan Forty equalising Adam Johnson's opener. But 2 goals in a couple of minutes from Darius Henderson and Marlon King have opened a gap that's a fair reflection. Watford have killed this off now. They lead 3-1.
Watford staying top. Charlton Barnsley was second against fourth at kickoff. Charlton 7 unbeaten, Barnsley 5 unbeaten. Dominic Cotton's at the Valley.
It's 0-0 with 15 minutes to play here, and the Charlton fans are getting very, very frustrated. Their team really should be in front. They've dominated this game for almost its entirety. The most recent chance, Darren Ambrose firing wide. He had time, he had space, but he couldn't hit the target. He's subsequently been substituted, and Jerome Thomas has come on. Fresh legs for Charlton as they go in search of what would be a winner. 0-0 in the 76th minute.
Two of last season's playoff clubs are playing at St Mary's, Southampton and West Bromwich Albion. Roger Johnson reporting.
Not much to choose between them, although the table has them miles apart. It's Southampton 3, West Brom 2. Southampton streaking into the lead through Stern John and Rudy Scatchell. 2 goals from Robert Corran, getting the Baggies briefly back on terms before a second from Stern John poking in to put Saints 3-2 ahead. But not over this one, the home side leading though.
Still time for the situation to change at Villa Park. Back to Ivan Gaskell.
Aston Villa 1, West Ham 0. It could change, but neither side have really threatened a goal until just a moment ago when Ashley Young drove another low cross, as he's done several times today. It flashed across towards the far post, just needed a touch, and substitute Sean Maloney sliding in almost provided it. Almost, but no cigar. 1-0.
Well, there was a penalty appeal there. Was it worthy of a penalty?
Yes. The appeal was justified. I'm not sure what the position the referee was. It couldn't have been a very good one, but for me, it was a penalty.
Do you agree, Gavin?
If he'd had a good view of it, he would have seen... Ashley Young does it great when he's on the left-hand side. He checks and whips these balls in with his right foot. And Lucas Neal is caught a little bit and leans like that. He leans his arm towards the ball, hits his arm in the box. For me, that's got to be his arm towards the ball. It's got to be a penalty.
Gary, are West Ham going to get back in this match?
They've certainly got enough possession to do it. Not creating a whole lot of chances. Carlton Cole's come close on 2 occasions. But you've got to give credit to Aston Villa. They defended well, conceded 4 goals last week. I think Martinez had a word, and they're looking a lot stronger at the back.
Red card in the Scunthorpe Watford game. Alan Biggs can tell us all about it.
Well, I don't think it's going to affect the result, but Watford are down to 10 men. Lee Williamson, quite justly and deservedly sent off. A totally unnecessary, flying, two-footed challenge. There was certainly no need for that. It was clearly a dangerous tackle, straight red card. Williamson's off. Watford down to 10 men. Just a bit of hope for Scunthorpe, who trail 3-1.
Now, let's hear from Mark Webber at Molineux for the Championship game between Wolves, who kicked off 11th, and Coventry 5th.
Ray, 0-0. If Mick McCarthy had consulted Mystic Meg this morning, he might have called off this game. 2 injuries in the first half, penalties and free kicks denied right, left and centre, and a bucket full of mixed chances. That's Wolves' lot for most of this game. Despite that, they've stayed strong and they've looked more like scoring than Coventry, who've been quick on the break but not promised as much. If I was Mick McCarthy, I wouldn't buy a lotto ticket tonight. His luck's not in. 0-0.
And Mansfield, bottom of the Football League, aren't going to get off the bottom, are they? They're 3-1 down away at Rotherham. Michael Boulding has pulled a goal back on 76 minutes, but it's Rotherham 3, Mansfield 1. Bit of a gap developing between Mansfield and the clubs above them. Lost six, won the next two. Lost the league leaders Watford in midweek. That was second bottom Sheffield Wednesday's record when they ran out for a home game with fourth bottom Leicester. David Garrido's at Hillsborough.
Still Wednesday nil, Leicester 2, Ray. Gareth McCauley and Patrick Kisnorbo with the early goals for the visitors. But the home side doing better since the break. Their best chance was when the two subs, Burton O'Brien and Francis Jeffers, combined well. But a point-blank save from Martin Phillip denied O'Brien. For Leicester, Sean Newton has had two superb chances to kill the game off, but missed both of them. It's still Wednesday nil, Leicester 2.
Cardiff's home form was 1 point from 12 at kickoff. Ninth place Burnley turned up having lost just one of eight league games played. Gareth Williams is watching the match at Ninian Park.
It's Cardiff City 2, Burnley 1. The only goal of the first half coming on 35 minutes when the ball was played from the right, and there unmarked was Cardiff midfielder Joe Ledley to head a pass Garbo Gorali in the Burnley goal. It was all square on 50 minutes. Ball played into the box where substitute Ali Akinbaye was ready to head a pass Oakes in the Cardiff goal, and then Cardiff restoring their lead on 54. Paul Powell received the ball on the right. He cut infield and challenged and shot past Gorali from 20 yards. Since Cardiff's second goal on 65 minutes, Robbie Fowler was replaced by Steve Thompson, who we were led to believe was injured himself before kickoff. And then 8 minutes later, Cardiff goal scorer Paul Parry saw an effort from 20 yards over the corner. It's Cardiff City 2, Burnley 1.
Well, 2 points separated Crystal Palace and Hull when they kicked off. Palace 18th, Hull 13th. Tony Lockwood has the latest, a goal.
Yes, a goal at last at Selhurst Park. Palace were poor. They've improved. They had to improve. They couldn't get much worse. And irony of ironies, they've taken the lead against Hull, who totally dominated the opening 45. The goal from James Scowcroft back in the Palace team, heading past the goalkeeper, Myhill. David Martin's cross, Scowcroft rose well. Downward header wide of Myhill. It's Palace 1, Hull City 0.
A goal in the MK Dons Bradford match. MK Dons top of League Two. Steve Lee reporting.
Yes, it's now MK Dons 2, Bradford 0. We waited 72 for the first goal from Keith Andrews. Well, 13 minutes later, we got another one. This time, Danny Swales after a goal-mouth scramble. And again, the Bradford substitute, Joe Colback, will have a lonely seat on the bus home. He gave away the free kick, which led to the scramble. 2-0, MK Dons.
And Nottingham Forest against Hartlepool is 8th against 5th in League One. Damian Johnson reporting.
We have a goal, Nottingham Forest 2, Hartlepool 1. The scorer, Junior Agogo, is a brilliant piece of skill from Chris Commons. He raced into the area, his shot was saved, and from an acute angle, Agogo followed up to score. 2-1 Forest.
League leaders Orient are getting thumped at home. Robin Bailey is watching Southend against Tranmere. This is 3rd against 2nd.
Yes, and it's Southend 1, Tranmere 2. It's Tranmere going top at the moment. They've only got about 9 minutes to go in this game. They thought they'd got a 3-1 lead a moment ago. Ian Goodison said he got the ball over the line. Well, the linesman said he hadn't, although they were furious, and so were the Tranmere fans behind the goal. So it's Gareth Taylor's goal which separates these sides. A triple substitution from the Southend manager, Steve Tilson, is possibly going to rescue it. Good finish in store here, but it's Southend 1, Tranmere 2.
Tranmere 8 unbeaten, look like they're going top of League One. Charlton Barnsley in the Championship, Dominic Cotton.
Charlton have the lead, it's been scored by Zheng Ji. A decent ball in by Andy Reid was headed back across goal by Chris Uwalumu. And there was the Chinese midfielder to push the ball through a crowded six-yard box. The goal had been coming, it's come now, the fans are on their feet. Charlton deserve the lead and they have it.
Bournemouth not won in six, lost the last three, but they're going to win this afternoon away at Crewe. And it's Darren Anderton on the score sheet again. 5 minutes from time, and it's pretty comprehensive, isn't it? Crewe 0, Bournemouth 4. To Bloomfield Road, Richard Ascombe watching Blackpool play Plymouth.
0-0 still, Ray, but not a bad game this. Blackpool almost broke the deadlock a moment ago. Keith Southern turning a cross against the post. Peter Hamosi has had a long-range drive at the other end. Both sides going for it.
Now, reaction to Manchester United's 4-0 victory over Wigan at lunchtime, a victory that's taken them top of the Barclays Premier League. Reaction from both teams.
Today in the second half, when Carlos Tevez scored, all players, they knew immediately that was our day. If we control the ball, if we control the tempo, the rhythm, especially if we keep possession, nothing could escape from us. I think the number of opportunities that we create justify the number of goals at the end of the game.
Chris, for 51 minutes, the game plan seemed to be working. Then Mario Melchiot went off. How significant was that?
Yeah, well, he had a little a thigh strain before the game. He picked up yesterday, so a little bit disappointed, but it did disrupt us. But in saying that, I was pleased with the first half, how we contained them. and the game plan worked. And obviously, you know, to concede the goal is, you know, a quality goal it was as well. So to concede then, obviously, it opens things up a little bit more. And as the game went on, we lost our shape. While it's always 1-0, you've always got a chance. But, you know, they capitalised on some little bit of poor defending and the quality players that they've got.
Manchester United, top of the table, played two games more than Arsenal, who play tomorrow. What's at the heart of Manchester United's season so far? The defence hasn't conceded for a long, long time.
That's right, and they needed them to be strong because they've not played the most fluent of football this season. They're trying to bed in new players, Tevez, Anderson, Nani. And, you know, obviously with the fitness worries of Louis Sahar, which has surfaced again today, they've missed that, maybe cutting edge up front. But Vidic and Ferdinand have been absolutely fantastic. Van der Sar's been back in top form. And once you've got that solid back four and clean sheets, it gives great confidence to the rest of the team.
Right, let's go to Portman Road. Mark Bishop watching. Ipswich against Preston.
Ipswich 2, Preston North End 0. But we have a penalty that's been given to Preston North End, Ray. The referee clearly convinced that Mellor was upended by the Ipswich keeper, Neil Alexander. And he has given the penalty as time ticks away. Remember, Ipswich Town are unbeaten at home this season and going for a club record, equaling a club record, 8 successive home league victories. Alexander far from happy with the referees remonstrating. Mr. Walker telling Alexander to get ready for the penalty kick, which it looks as if Mellor himself, the man who was fouled, is going to take it. About 3 minutes plus stoppage time. Ipswich 2, Preston North End 0. Mellor hands on hip, waiting for the referee to give the signal. He does. Up steps Mellor, right footed into the back of the net. And Preston North End are back in this game. Around 3 minutes plus a lot of stoppage time as we've had two big injuries. So it's Ipswich 2, Preston North End 1.
Bottom of the Football League, Mansfield. Five defeats on the bounce. We're well down away at Rotherham, but they're back in the game. Still a chance to save a point at least. Nathan Arnold with 7 minutes to go. Mansfield have got two goals back. Rotherham 3, Mansfield 2. Barnet going to be winners this afternoon away at Stockport. Barnet on a rather decent run. They've won the last three. Steve Sutton's watching Hearts against Falkirk in the SPL.
Yes, Ray, another goal. It's Hearts 4, Falkirk 1. They've got a consolation goal back. Graham Barrett, a late second-half substitute with the goal. Hearts stood still and basically watched him walk it into the net. Thought it was offside. No whistle, no flag. So Falkirk get a consolation. It's 4-1.
Well, warming up at Villa Park, Ivan Gaskell.
Yes, Villa 1, West Ham 0. Gabby Agbon Lahore's just gone close for Villa, and Zat Knight really should have done better. West Ham have made a double substitution. Noble and Bo Morty on for Mullins and Etherington. Villa's excellent Martin Lauesen's in the wars, a nasty-looking head injury, blood everywhere. Terry Butcher-esque, really. He looked like he worked in a butcher's when they'd finished with him. Now wearing a huge bandage, looks like an extra from Holby City. But slowly, steadily, Villa closing in on a fourth consecutive home league win and being made to sweat for it. 1-0.
When it's only 1-0, it's never certain. Can you see West Ham just snatching something?
It's possible, with the game in the perilous state it is now for Aston Villa, but Lucas Neal should consider himself very lucky. I've seen one possible penalty and, two possible penalties from Lucas Neal.
You see another goal in this game?
Yeah, I mean, West Ham have had a great deal of possession in the second half. First half, they were blown away, but second half, they've had a lot more of the ball. Just need to get that cutting edge.
What's your reading, Gavin?
Well, I said at half-time, the fact that Villa had a lot of pressure in the first half and only had one goal to their name for it, they may rue that. West Ham have had a lot of possession in this second half, but still, Villa should have had... Garth said possible one, but possible two. Possible I would say two. Definite two penalties.
Final whistle starting to sound. Hearts 4, Falkirk 2 in Scotland. Let's hear about that from Steve Sutton.
Yes, Ray, I thought it was just a consolation at 4-1, but Falkirk have pulled back another one through Moutinho. It's 4-2, there's 2 minutes added on time to go. Hearts are all over the place now. They sat back and they've let Falkirk creep their way back in. Probably not enough time, but we certainly have a finish now.
Let's go to Ibrox. This could be a sensational result for Hibs, Brian McLaughlin.
It certainly would be, Ray, and now in stoppage time, it's Rangers 0, Hibs 1, and it's Rangers who are pushing very, very hard for an equaliser. Davy Weir has twice come close, but a warning for him just a few moments ago. Clayton Donaldson coming close to adding a second goal for Hibs. Dramatic stuff here at Ibrox. Rangers 0, Hibs 1.
League leaders in Scottish Division 3, East Fife. Another win this afternoon, 4-0 at home to Albion. Very pretty confirming Dundee United have beaten Motherwell by a goal to nil. Let's hear about that match from Ian Turner.
Well, 5 out of 5 home league games without conceding a goal, and Dundee United, thanks to Darren Dodd's back post header from a Barry Robson corner, have continued their impressive start to the season. Chances came and went for both sides prior to Dodd's late winner. Hughes and Clarkson couldn't find the net after rounding United keeper Zamo Tulski, while Noel Hunt could have had 3 goals for Craig Levein's side had his finishing matched the rest of his all-round game. Good win for United. They win over Motherwell by 1-0.
Leeds unbeaten are going to go out of the bottom half of the table. They've taken the lead late in the game at home to Yeovil. Mark de Vries on 89 minutes. Sensational start of the season by Leeds continues. Leeds 1, Yeovil 0. To Selhurst Park, Tony Lockwood, Palace playing Hull.
Hull City have an equaliser, Rayville. Say it was deserved because they played the better football throughout this game. Michael Turner upended in that Palace box, and Dean Marley, who'd struck a post in the opening 45 minutes with the precise spot kick wide of Speroni. It's 1-1 at Selhurst Park.
Palace have only won 2 games so far this season. That is a match they expect to take 3 points from. The leaders, Watford, are away at Scunthorpe. Alan Biggs.
Well, it could be more than 3-1 by the end. John O'Toole just getting the ball into the Scunthorpe net, but that disallowed by the referee. Some mercy for Scunthorpe, who hit the post through. Martin Patterson with the score at 3-1, and have had the encouragement of Watford down to 10 men with Lee Williamson sent off. Watford, though, still looking for more goals. They lead 3-1.
Final whistle in the Hearts-Falkirk match. Steve Sutton reporting.
Hearts 4, Falkirk 2. The scoreline suggests a little closer than it was in reality. The game turned on its head, in effect, in the last 5 minutes when Falkirk stole 2 late consolation goals. But they basically ran out of time. Hearts, for the majority of the game, ran the show. They've now got 6 wins in their last 7. Winners 4-2 this afternoon.
Result of the day, perhaps. Hibs 1-up away at Ibrox. Rangers hoping to go back to the top of the SPL table. Celtic play tomorrow. Charlton Barnsley in the Championship. Dominic Cotton.
Yes, and Barnsley a level in the 89th minute. A cruel blow, some pretty poor defending from Charlton. And Kim Christiansen, the Dane, he'd come on as a second-half substitute for Barnsley. Hammered the ball through some pretty uncertain Charlton defenders. Misery for Charlton and Alan Pardew. Barnsley look like they've grabbed a last-minute point.
Well, Charlton unbeaten in 7, Barnsley unbeaten in 5, and Barnsley making a terrific start to the season. They needed a run of games last year to get away from the relegation places. They kicked off 4th. Southampton, West Bromwich Albion. Albion a 3rd at kick-off. Roger Johnson.
They could be slipping, though. Southampton still lead by 3-2. They're holding on, though. Albion throwing it all forward. They've made 2 substitutions as we move into 5 minutes of added time here, which will disgruntle the home supporters. It may give Albion the chance they need, though, to get back into things, because they are the ones who've been asking all the questions in the final few minutes here. Southampton, though, hanging on. 3-2.
Blue Square Premier leaders Torquay losing away at Ebbsfleet United. Frayed tempers of Villa Park. Ivan Gaskell.
Yes, a bit of frustration. Villa trying to count the clock down here. No less than 4 minutes of injury time. Sean Maloney right at the heart of it, the youngster, very confident-looking boy, came on as a sub, and trying to keep the ball in the bottom corner. The West Ham players didn't like it at all, and, it all got a bit silly. Then they shook hands. They're playing again, and at the moment, Villa hanging on.
Now, what a sensation in the SPL. Unbeaten Hibs, top of the table, Brian McLaughlin.
Remarkable scoreline, Ray. Rangers 0, Hibs 1. That scoreline sending Hibs to the top of the SPL. David Murphy, the hero, heading home his first goal of the season. Philip Moraes and Antoine Currie almost doubled their advantage, whilst Rangers' best efforts came from Chris Boyd and Charlie Adam. But take nothing away from John Colin Hibbs' side, who were absolutely magnificent throughout the 90 minutes. A fully deserved victory. It finished at Ibrox.
Closing stages in all this afternoon's games. To Ninian Park, Cardiff Burnley, Gareth Williams.
Cardiff 2, Burnley 1, and at long last the Bluebirds secured a win at home for the first time this season. It came courtesy of a workmanlike performance from the Bluebirds, but they didn't have it all their own way. Cardiff taking the lead on 35 minutes when Joe Ledley's header beat Pirelli in goal. The closest the Clarus came to a first-half goal was a Robbie Blake shot that just went over the bar. Steve Cockrell made 3 changes for the visitors at half-time, and it certainly worked when Adi Akinbay headed past Oaks on 50 minutes. 4 minutes later, Cardiff restored their lead when Paul Power received the ball on the Bluebirds' right. He cut infield unchallenged and shot past Kiraly from 20 yards. Just under 13,000 people saw it finish. Cardiff City 2, Burnley 1.
League One leaders Orient have crashed at home to Swansea today. Swansea kicked off in sixth place. They've now won four of the last six games. And after a great start, Orient have now lost three of the last four. So it could be the Tranmere Rovers go top of League One. Back to the Championship. Palace Hull, Tony Lockwood.
For 45 minutes, Hull City ran the show. Julian Speroni in the home goal outstanding. Di Marni hit a Palace post. The host improved. David Martin's cross headed home by James Scowcroft. A Di Marni penalty levelled it up. Hull worth the points. Palace and Peter Taylor booed off. Palace 1, Hull City 1.
Full-time in the Nottingham Forest-Hartlepool game, Damian Johnson.
It's finished 2-1. Nottingham Forest manager Colin Calderwood said in midweek that his side had finally learned to play with patience. Well, they certainly showed that, waiting for Junior Agogo's winner. Chris Commons put Forest in front, poking home from close range early on. Richie Barker equalised with a header before the break. It was pretty even in the second half too. Paul's Ian Moore tested Paul Smith from distance, but the best openings fell to Forest, and they eventually got their reward. A fine move saw Commons break into the area. His shot was parried, but Agogo followed up to score from an acute angle. 2-1 Forest.
A goal at Molineux, Mark Webber.
Mick McCarthy, buy that lottery ticket tonight, because you're 1-0 up. Neil Collins, last-minute header, third minute of injury time. Fantastic opportunity, 1-0 to the Wolves.
League Two leaders MK Dons at home to Bradford. Steve Lee.
All over here, MK Dons 2, Bradford 0. Six wins on the trot for Paul Ince's side now. Not all plain sailing, though. Bradford held out until 18 minutes from the end. MK Dons captain Keith Andrews scoring after a knockdown from Wilbraham. Danny Swales scrambled in the second. Barry Conlon pulled back with a late penalty for Bradford. But MK Dons stay top, 2-0.
Final whistle at Villa Park. Back to Ivan Gaskell.
Yes, 1-0 Aston Villa at the end. Not quite five-star entertainment, but you won't hear the Villa natives complaining. Villa's fourth consecutive home league win, probably deserved on the basis of really a fine first half an hour in which they had an eye-catching forward line that had West Ham reeling and had them behind too. Craig Gardner's free kick in off Gabidon in a tense hour that followed. Lucas Neal was lucky maybe to get away with a couple of tight penalty appeals. Villa, though, sweating by the end, but relieved now. 1-0 winners.
Aston Villa up to fifth. Tomorrow's games will change that, of course. Final whistle at Molineux. Mark Webber, dramatic conclusion to the game.
Yes, and I don't know whether you can hear the crowd. They're saying what most people are thinking. At last, the ball went in the back of the net. A worthy goal for Wolves, who witnessed injustice in the form of dodgy decisions, blood in the fact that two of their players went off injured in the first half, and opportunities galore. Coventry were good in parts, sporadic in other periods. They could have got one goal in this sud, but really, Wolves dominated. It was their game. Justice has been served. Wolves 1, Coventry 0.
Unbeaten in four and climbing the table. Charlton Barnsley, second versus fourth, the kick-off, Dominic Cotton.
Finished Charlton 1, Barnsley 1, and Charlton were always in charge here, but having gone in front late on, let their guard down to surrender the win. Andy Reid led the way from midfield, going close himself and supplying teammates. Well, Zheng Ji had good chances in the second half before Grant McCann fired wide at the other end after Nicky Weaver had failed to hold a high ball. More Charlton pressure eventually told, and Ji was the man to prod the ball into the net for a goal his team richly deserved. But late on came that cruel equaliser. Poor defending let Barnsley in, and substitute Kim Christensen hammered it unchallenged from close range. A truly frustrating climax for the hosts.
Stoke haven't lost in seven games. Harry Grayson. Stoke City 2, Colchester 1 is the full-time score. I'll bring you a report on that a little bit later. Eventful this afternoon at St Mary's, Roger Johnson.
Where it's finished, Southampton 3, West Bromwich Albion 2. The Championship's leakiest defence, hosting the most prolific attack. We're always likely to give us goals, perhaps not this scoreline. Stern John and Rudy Scatchell lash Southampton clear. Two goals from Robert Corran brought Albion back into it, but only briefly. Stern John's tap-in sealed the points. Southampton, though, had to endure a nervy finish before beating West Brom 3-2.
Let's hear about the Championship leaders Watford away at Scunthorpe, Alan Biggs.
Scunthorpe 1, Watford 3, and the most ominous aspect of the leaders' performance is that they were still looking for goals, even from 3-1 up and down to 10 men. The only thing not professional about it was the red card for Lee Williamson for a reckless challenge, with the match already won by goals from Adam Johnson and then Darius Henderson and Marlon King, two in a couple of minutes from them after Jonathan Fort's first half leveller. Watford win 3-1.
In League One, Tranmere Rovers go top of the table. Robin Bailey.
Southend 1, Tranmere 2. A fine performance by the Merseysiders. Ben Chorley put them ahead in the first half. Adam Barrett pegged them back before half-time. There wasn't a cigarette paper between these two at that stage. Gareth Taylor's majestic header won it for them 10 minutes after the break. Ronnie Moore should be proud. And John Achterberg in goal was outstanding today. 2-1 to Tranmere.
All the results are just about in. Time for Tim Gudgeon to confirm today's final scores.
Opening with the Barclays Premier League, Aston Villa 1, West Ham United 0. Manchester United 4, Wigan Athletic 0. The Coca-Cola Championship, Blackpool 0, Plymouth Argyle 0. Bristol City and Sheffield United have an evening kickoff. Cardiff City 2, Burnley 1. Charlton Athletic 1, Barnsley 1. Crystal Palace 1, Hull City 1. Ipswich Town 2, Preston North End 1. Scunthorpe United 1, Watford 3. Sheffield Wednesday 0, Leicester City 2. Southampton 3, West Bromwich Albion 2. Stoke City 2, Colchester United 1. Wolverhampton Wanderers 1, Coventry City 0. League 1, Brighton and Hove Albion 0, Bristol Rovers 0. Carlisle United 4, Millwall 0. Cheltenham Town 1, Oldham Athletic 1. Crewe Alexandra 1, Bournemouth 4. Leeds United 1, Yeovil Town 0. Leyton Orient 0, Swansea City 5. Luton Town 1, Doncaster Rovers 1. Northampton Town 2, Port Vale 1. Nottingham Forest 2, Hartlepool United 1. Southend United 1, Tranmere Rovers 2. Swindon Town 5, Gillingham 0. Walsall 4, Huddersfield Town 0. League 2, Chesterfield 2, Macclesfield Town 2. Dagenham and Redbridge 0, Darlington 3. Hereford United 2, Brentford 0. Lincoln City 1, Morecambe 1. Milton Keynes Dons 2, Bradford City 1. Peterborough United 2, Grimsby Town 1. Rochdale 1, Bury 2. Rotherham United 3, Mansfield Town 2. Stockport County 2, Barnet 4. Wycombe Wanderers 3, Notts County 1. The Blue Square Premier, Altrincham 1, Rushton and Diamonds 2. Burton Albion 4, Salisbury 3. Cambridge United 2, Halifax Town 2. Droylsden and Oxford United kick off this evening. Ebbsfleet United 2, Torquay United 1. Exeter City 1, Grays Athletic 0. Kidderminster Harriers 1, Crawley Town 1. Stafford Rangers 1, Forest Green Rovers 3. Stevenage Borough 3, Aldershot Town 1. Weymouth 2, North of Victoria 0. York City 1, Histon 4. The Clydesdale Bank Scottish Premier League, Dundee United 1, Motherwell 0. Hearts 4, Falkirk 2. Kilmarnock 2, Inverness Caledonian Thistle 2. Rangers 0, Hibernian 1. Anbrew Scottish Division 1, Hamilton Academicals 2, Dundee 0. Livingston 0, St Johnston 2. Morton 4, Partick Thistle 2. Queen of the South 0, Dunfermline Athletic 1. Stirling Albion 0, Clyde 2. Scottish Div 2, Airdrie United 0, Ayr United 0. Berwick Rangers 0, Alloa Athletic 3. Peterhead 0, Raith Rovers 1. Queen's Park 0, Cowdenbeath 1. Ross County 2, Brechin City 1. And Scottish Div 3, Dumbarton 0, Forfar Athletic 0. East 5, 4, Albion Rovers 0. Montrose 3, Erse East Stirling 1. Stenhouse Muir 2, Elgin City 3. Stranraer 1, Arbroath 1.
And Gavin Peacock, Gary Pallister and Garth Crooks will offer their opinions on the significance of those results after we've looked at the updated league tables. And in the Barclays Premier League, what a familiar look to the top of the table. Champions Manchester United are in pole position after recording their sixth straight win this afternoon. They beat Wigan 4-0 to move a point ahead of Arsenal. Could be short-lived, though. Arsenal, who have two games in hand, will return to the top if they avoid defeat against Sunderland tomorrow. Only other movers in the top half of the table are Aston Villa. They're up from 9th to 5th after beating West Ham 1-0. As you were in the bottom half of the table, with 11th-placed West Ham and 14th-placed Wigan both losing, all the other teams are in action tomorrow. in the Coca-Cola Championship. Watford are 4 points clear at the top after winning 3-1 at Scunthorpe. That's now 7 games unbeaten for the Hornets. Charlton lost ground after a late equaliser gave Barnsley a 1-1 draw at the Valley. Third place West Bromwich Albion went down to their first league defeat since August, losing 3-2 at Southampton. And Stoke are up to fourth after beating Colchester 2-1 at the Britannia Stadium. Struggling Queen's Park Rangers and Norwich are in action on Monday night in a match of real importance at the bottom. But today, Sheffield Wednesday went down to their 8th defeat in 10 games, with Gary Megson getting his first league win as the new Leicester boss at Hillsborough. And Preston were beaten 2-1 at Ipswich, who've now won their last 8 games at Portman Road. In League One, Tranmere Rovers are the new leaders. Ronnie Moore's side beat Southend 2-1 to move above Leighton Orient on goal difference. Orient had a nightmare this afternoon, beaten 5-0 at home by Swansea, who climbed to fourth. Sandwiched between Orient and Swansea in third place are Carlisle, who gave their new manager John Ward a dream start with a 4-0 win over Millwall. Nottingham Forest climbed to fifth after a 2-1 win over Hartlepool. Millwall's 4-0 defeat to Carlisle sees them slip to the bottom. They're below Bournemouth on goal difference. Bournemouth picked up only their second win of the season, an impressive 4-1 success at Crewe. Port Vale fall a place after losing 2-1 at Northampton. Cheltenham complete the bottom four. They had Jeremy Gill sent off in their 1-1 draw with Oldham. And a word for Leeds, who climbed to 12th after a 1-0 win over Yeovil. They'd be 9 points clear at the top if it wasn't for their 15-point penalty. And League Two. MK Dons stay top, seeing off Bradford City with a 2-1 win. Hereford, Darlington and Barnet all win as well to strengthen their positions. Chesterfield lose some ground with a 2-2 draw at home to lowly Macclesfield, while Chester City play Shrewsbury tomorrow. Mansfield are now 5 points from safety at the bottom of the Football League after losing 3-2 at Rotherham. That's their 8th defeat in 10 matches. Lincoln City have now picked up just 2 points from a possible 21. A 1-1 home draw with Morecambe leaves the Red Imps in trouble. Bury are the big movers, jumping 7 places to 13th, with victory at neighbours Rochdale, who dropped to 19th. And in the Blue Square Premier, Torquay's lead has been cut to a point. They were beaten 2-1 at Ebbsfleet United. Stevenage beat Aldershot 3-1 to move above the Shots into second place. More misery for Northwich at the bottom. They suffered defeat number 12, losing 2-0 at Weymouth. Drawlsden host Oxford United this evening. And in the Clydesdale Bank Scottish Premier League, Hibs are the new leaders after Rangers suffered a Champions League hangover at Ibrox. David Murphy headed the only goal as Hibs maintained their unbeaten league record. Celtic can retain top spot with victory against Gretna tomorrow. Fourth place Dundee United beat Motherwell 1-0 at Tannadice, where they've yet to concede a league goal this season. Hearts comfortably beat Falkirk, while Kilmarnock and Inverness shared the points in a 2-2 draw at Rugby Park. Aberdeen and St Mirren also meet tomorrow, and Celtic, of course, have their game tomorrow. Back to Villa Park now. John Motson commentated on the Aston Villa-West Ham game for Match of the Day. John, what's your reading the way this game went?
Well, I have to be honest, Ray, it got off to a bright start, particularly from Aston Villa, but by the end, I think we were watching two teams who, on this form, will finish mid-table at best. Steve McLaren was in the crowd. I don't know what conclusions he drew. I don't think Dean Ashton played well enough to put himself in the frame for a starting position for England next Saturday. Ashley Young had a good first half for Watford on the left flank. He's a player who I think one day, perhaps, if Sean Wright Phillips or Joe Cole weren't available, might squeeze into the England team in the future. And Agbon Lahore also showed some nice touches, but of course he's still at under 21 level. There wasn't a great deal to be gleaned from this, Ray, apart from the fact, as you might see on Match of the Day tonight, there were 5 penalty appeals, all of which the referee, Mr. Tanner, waved to one side.
John, what are your thoughts on the fact that that match was the only 3 o'clock kickoff this afternoon in the top flight of English football?
Well, I think it's been well documented, Ray, that the UEFA Cup has become a problem now on a Thursday night, in as much as matches are already moved to Sunday for television. Now we've got 4 games being moved to a Sunday because the teams have played on a Thursday. I think that needs addressing in some shape or form, but that's a European problem rather than a Premier League problem. Aston Villa and West Ham had the chance to take the spotlight here, but they didn't really seize it the way I thought they might.
I don't know if you saw the match, John, but it was a bit of a cruise for Manchester United at lunchtime.
Well, I think that was always on the cards, wasn't it? I mean, one day they were going to catch fire. Tevez obviously got them going. And when you've got him, Ronaldo and Rooney, you expect them to score goals at some point. I would imagine now that the Championship will start to take a bit of shape. The problem we've got now is, just as Manchester United go top and Arsenal play tomorrow, we then have a two-week break before anybody plays again. That's another very sort of strange thing about the way our season is constructed now. But certainly, I think with Liverpool up there too and Chelsea no doubt getting back to form at some point, it's going to be a better title fight than it was last year.
John, thanks very much. It was very nearly match of the day tonight. Aston Villa versus West Ham, one of the two games played. Manchester United games with Wigan was the other. Highlights of both games tonight at 10:15. What's your verdict on the Aston Villa-West Ham match, Garth?
Well, I thought it was... John was absolutely right. Too many penalty appeals turned down for me, and I think match of the day will prove that to be correct. And as far as West Ham were concerned, they had chances to level and they missed it.
Manchester United were pretty comfortable winners today. Defensively, they look very strong at the moment. I don't think they've conceded in around about 10 hours.
No, that's a fantastic platform to give the rest of the team. Vidic and Ferdinand have been ever so strong there. Evra, they've got the problem at right back. They've been chopping and changing. Wes Brown's done ever so well from this year. They'll be waiting for Gary Neville to come back, but it does give them a great platform.
Yeah, looking good, Manchester United. Not hitting the heights, as people are saying, but winning games.
And that's, you know, when you have a crisis of injuries like they had at the beginning of the season, it takes a while, so you deal with what you've got and you say, right, we've got to be tight at the back, and the defence becomes very mean. And that's the way that they've gone about it. We know all about their attacking flair. When they get it right, they're an awesome sight to watch. And no doubt about it, they're going to be up there and they've got a very good chance of winning it again.
And four goals this morning, this afternoon for Manchester United. Let's hear from Ryan Giggs on the back of that game.
First half, very frustrating, I would imagine.
Yeah, it was. You know, Wigan come with a game plan, getting people behind the ball. And it was a bit of a stop-start, really, first half. Players going down injured. You know, having to tamper with a back four. Players coming on, players going off. So we didn't really get into the flow of things, probably until the last 10 minutes of the first half. So it was a bit frustrating, but we knew that if we were patient, that the chances would come.
What was the main difference in the second half? Did you use the width more?
Yeah, I think so. I think the movement overall, our tempo was a lot quicker. We spread the play and everyone contributed, really. So, and it makes a difference once that first goal goes in. Wigan have got to come out and play, and it leaves gaps for players, you know, like Wayne and Cristiano and Carlos to capitalise on.
Manchester United, top of the Barclays Premier League. There's the programme plans for tomorrow. It covers the eight Barclays Premier League games that will be played. First of all, there's the fixture list. Arsenal kick off the day at midday at home to Sunderland. Reading versus Derby is a 2 o'clock kick-off. At 3 o'clock, Blackburn play Birmingham, Bolton play Chelsea. Fulham Portsmouth gets going just after 4 o'clock. And there are 3 o'clock kick-offs too at Anfield, the City of Manchester Stadium, and St James's Park, where Everton are the visitors. Press the red button from 3 o'clock onwards for a full score service. You can also access the programme via the BBC Sport website. It's final score on BBC Two at 10 to 5. And Match of the Day 2 has a 10 o'clock start tomorrow night and will feature action from all eight games. Well, let's hear from a disappointed manager, Alan Kerbishley, after defeat at Villa Park.
Alan, it's never an easy question to pose to a manager that's just been beaten. How did that rate for you today?
Well, I think we've done enough to get a point. I don't know what Martin's going to say about it, but I think we deserve the point from the game at least. And, you know, the first goal, obviously the decider, but we've done enough second half to get ourselves back in it. And we're desperately disappointed we haven't picked nothing up.
The goal that proved the winner came from a free kick right on the edge of your own penalty area. Was that right?
No, I think he's completely wrong. And I told him as well. You know, everyone says you're going to win some, you're going to lose some. We've had two decisions in the last 2 weeks now. You know, Freddie Lundberg's goal against Arsenal was a good goal. And today, I think the centre-forward, they were scrapping for the ball on the edge of the box and then he has slipped over and there's no contact and the ref's got it wrong. And to compound it, it's a hit Danny Gabbidon and gone in.
Garth, you think Alan Kirby has a case, don't you?
I do, very much so. I didn't think the free kick on the edge of the box was. Steve Tanner got that completely wrong. I think Alan Kirby is totally justified. But it's strange, you know, if a striker had missed five chances in the game, you'd expect him to be severely hauled over the coals. You don't expect a referee to miss five decisions that two of which were stonewall penalties. There was a claim for five penalties, in actual fact, but to miss all five and not give what I thought was a clear two is unusual.
Do you go along with this, or are we on just on the case of officials a little bit too much?
No, got to get it right. And, I mean, everyone's going to make mistakes. Officials will make mistakes. They are only human. I suppose if you're making a lot, like, I mean, we saw quite clearly, I mean, Lucas Neal gave away two clear-cut penalties for me. Mm-hmm. And there were other instances on top of that. You might miss one, you might get one decision wrong, but you can't continue to do it.
Where do you stand on this, Gary?
It's a tough job for referees. You're expecting help from your linesman, and certainly in a couple of the decisions, I think the linesman could have helped the referee. It wasn't to be. The Lucas Neal handball is very difficult to ball. We didn't spot it in real time. When we saw the replay, it was a stonewall penalty. So it is a difficult job for the referees, but when you've got five penalty claims, you've got to get one of them right.
Well, it might not be Saturday, but it could be a fascinating afternoon tomorrow, couldn't it, with all the games?
It's going to be amazing. Arsenal will have to respond tomorrow. They probably will. At home to Sunderland, but right through this, the
Chelsea and Bolton.
Yeah, there's been some very interesting
For both teams up there as well. Yeah. And of course, Liverpool need to push on as well.
Guys, thanks very much. For news on any English or Scottish club, the My Club service is available. Text My Club and the name of your club, Luton Town, for example, to 81010. A link to the section on that club on the BBC Sport website will be sent to your mobile phone. And full details on all today's football are on the BBC Sport website. All the results, the goal scorers, the tables and previews on tomorrow's matches. And today's football service continues now on BBC iPlayer. Press the red button and follow the links to stay with us here in the Final Score studio. 10:15 start for Match of the Day. This is where we close on BBC One. It's bye for now.